morning, everyone. Thank you for the invitation. It's really a great pleasure for me to be here to talk about my research. I just have a very little chat with some of the colleagues here. Probably I'm not the only physicist here. I'm really great about that because I'm quite worried. Like my physics background will be scared everyone here. So my talk today is about nanoscale engineered plasmonic structures for sensing and imaging. I'm from materials department, Imperial College London, and this is where we are sitting. We are surrounded by some famous museums and the Royal Albert Hall here, and also backed up by this Hyde Park. And this is our materials department building. I'm working on plasmonic materials. So we do theoretical simulation, and then we design materials, and we do the fabrication. By manipulating with the light, manipulating the optical properties of such material, we can apply plasmonic materials in healthcare and in solar energy harvesting. But today I'm going to only focus on healthcare technologies. We are sitting in engineering departments, so the main purpose is making something practical for sensing and imaging. So the material we are making, they are large scale and with long homogeneity, so they can be reproducible. And especially for sensing application, you want to have the sensitivity not reproducible. Before I talk about plasmonic materials, I want to give you a very brief fluorescence. What is fluorescence? I believe everyone here is very familiar with this confocal fluorescence-based confocal image. The cells can be stained by fluorescence, and you can understand the features of cells. This is the what I said is physical aspect of the fluorescent dyes you are using. You have emission peak, and then you have this excitation curve and emission. And this fluorescence spectroscopy is invented by Jablonski. He has a paper published in Nature back in 1933, and this is famous Jablonski diagram, probably you can't see here. So a fluorophore can absorb the energy. So the energy, they can jump from ground state to fourth state, and then coming down with emitting fluorescence. I will talk about in more detail later. So what is plasmonic materials? Plasmonic materials basically is gold, silver, copper, nanoparticles. They have the optical properties called localized surface plasma resonance. So basically, the electrons on the surface of metal will be vibrated due to the and coupled to the electromagnetic field on the surface of this gold. It's very localized, so the electrons wouldn't fly away. They will just stay on the surface with certain degree. And here is a good example showing when you change the size and shape of nanoparticles under the confocal microscope, a dark field microscope, you will see the nanorods, spheric gold nanoparticles, two different sides of triangles will give you different color. Why you can see these two different, three or four different colors? This is because the oscillation frequency at different wavelengths. So this is called plasmonic peaks. Another famous example is this cup sitting in British Museum, being made in the 4th century. So the Asian people, they use colloidal nanoparticles, gold nanoparticle in exactly, stand the glass, and under the refraction, you can see this vibrant green color. If you put the light source inside the cup, you will see this brilliant red color. So this is all because of the excitation of the LSPRs. Nanoparticles has been popular for maybe more than a few centuries. Gold or silver or whatever metal, noble metal nanoparticles, they can absorb the light and they has the ability to scatter back the energy into the system, or some of the energy will lost as heat. By using the optical property of nanoparticles, there are three different techniques has been developed. One is called LSPR sensor and surface enhanced Raman. I'm working on this metal induced fluorescence enhancement. So in a simple term, how many of you working on the assays? So if you're working on the bioassays, you're putting down this bioassay on glass substrates, and you measure the intensity of the fluorescence, which represents the concentration of whatever markers, antigens you are detecting, you detect. And if we replace this glass substrate with some, or we're putting down some gold or silver nanoparticles on the surface, you're putting the same assay on the array, on this gold array, the fluorescence signal can be amplified because of the metal underneath. So what's the mechanism of this fluorescence enhancement? I will just briefly go through this because not everyone is in physics field. So this, we can observe when you put fluorophore on close to the metal surface, you will see the greater quantum yield of the fluorophore and also reduced lifetime. This is because the fluorescence has been enhanced by the excitation enhancement and emission enhancement. This excitation enhancement is simply because the nanoparticles, when they are close to each other, the electromagnetic field will be coupled, so will be amplified in between the gap. So this field enhancement is just like you put 10 times or 100 times stronger laser shining on your fluorophore. So this is a physical phenomenon. And in this simplified Jablonski diagram, you can see fluorophores being excited to the fourth grade after a bit relaxation, and you're coming down through this radiative channel, radiative decay channel, and non-radiative decay channel. When the fluorophore is very close to the metallic surface, they will, by controlling the distance between the fluorophore and metal surface, we can generate an additional channel for the radiative decay. Radiative decay means the fluorophore would emit more light. So in that way, the quantum yield being enhanced. It sounds like a magic. You're putting a fluorophore close to metal surface, you see the stronger signal. But this is actually need to be controlled precisely. When the distance between the fluorophore to the metal surface is within 5 nanometers, the fluorescence actually can be quenched. If we can control the distance between 5 to 20 nanometers, the fluorescence can be enhanced. After the distance bigger than 20 nanometers, the fluorophore wouldn't feel the electromagnetic field on the metal surface, so it's like a free space fluorescence. And the maximum enhancement normally is around 10 nanometers. So the next section, I'm going to talk about the nanostructures we can make in our lab. This technology is called nanosphere lithography. So you have a clean substrate, normally confocal microscope slides. You clean it, and you're putting down a monolayer of polystyrene and do the gold or silver, whatever metal you want, evaporation. After remove these polystyrene bits, you will get these triangular arrays of gold. And this is how the actual samples look like. You can see the different vibrant color. This is because of the reflection of the metals, because we are using different sizes of polystyrenes. By combining with any other techniques like iron milling or etching, plasma etching, we can actually making nano pillars or nano holes. I don't want to go to details about the technique. This is what we can make, basically. We can make these hexagonal arrays, triangular size, and some like the tiny pyramid shape, nano disc stuff, and we call this nano pencil, and a ring structure here. And they are quite useful for a lot of sensing, and we'll talk about later. So just now, the nanosphere lithography is a top-down approach. in nanotechnology term. And we can also synthesize nanoparticles. I think everyone here is familiar with gold colloidal nanoparticles. And we can make some kosher nanoflowers. And recently, we developed a technique to making these beautiful nanostars. And also, by putting a dielectric core inside this nanostar, you will see the plasmonic response can be tuned from the visible to IR region 2. So the force field in my early years, we are just working on these fluorescence enhancement investigation. So we just want to see what kind of substrates give us how many times of fluorescence enhancements. So this first paper, we're working on to study the fluorescence from quenching to enhancement. So we made this 12 nanometers gold colloidal and self-assembled them on the glass substrate. And in this triangular area, so probably you can see from here, in this triangular area, we have the metallic triangle here. And this is confocal microscope imaging. You can see on the metallic surface, the fluorescence being quenched, and the glass surface has higher fluorescence intensity. When we increase the particle size to 27 nanometers by by using silver enhancing solution, we can't see much effect. So it's neither quenched or enhanced. When we further increase the size to 47 nanometer, these nanocosher structures, we observe the fluorescence enhancement of 10 in these triangular metallic structures. And then another paper we published is everyone says gold will actually quench the fluorescence back in early 2008 or 2007. This is first report saying gold actually can enhance the fluorescence, but we need to use much bigger gold. So the gold particles with 80, 120, and 160 diameters, and we observe the fixie. Fluorescence enhancements up to 16 times. And this is the fringe image. You probably know this is a fluorescence lifetime image. And you can see the lifetime on the metallic surface. It's much lower, so it's about 100 picoseconds. While on the glass surface, which is similar to the free space, the original lifetime is 2.2 nanoseconds. So lifetime has been shortened dramatically. And then we move to this top-down method, making these beautiful triangular arrays. With different sides and different gaps in between. So there's a model here, and based on the model, we're making these substrates. And we try to match the LX fluorophore 790 with both excitation and emission being covered completely by these purple color substrates. And we observed two orders of magnitude fluorescence enhancements using silver triangular arrays. So this is a kind of breakthrough because most of the time people report 10 times, 20 times. And this is the first time we observed two orders of magnitude enhancement. Again, we use three different sizes of polystyrene as a template, 300 nanometers, 500 nanometers, and 620. And this is the FDTD modeling about the electromagnetic field. And here you can see, this is the like a heating map. You can see the more red means the electromagnetic field has been enhanced more for these corresponding three substrates. And that's why we observe the maximum fluorescence enhancements in these middle substrates. After we observe these total fluorescence enhancements, we can actually do the lifetime measurements. And using the original quantum yield of the dye LX fluorophore 790 and all these four equations, so this is the quantum yield and the lifetime equation, original equation. And after the when they close to metal, we modified the equation. So using these four equations, we can actually calculate the new quantum yield when they are on the metal surface. For example, for this particular dye, the original quantum yield is 10%. But when they being placed close to this particular substrate, the triangular arrays, the quantum yield is 72%. The next few slides, you probably will be more interested in that slide. The next section I'm talking about user example is called protein microarray using plasmonic material. So this is, we call this gold island. It's very simple to make. You make gold sit on the surface, and then you use certain reducing agents and gold ions to keep growing. So this is called gold island film chips. And we measure the optical response. It's about 600, but they have a big shoulder because inhomogeneous of the sides here. And the force, we're putting down these Psi 5 and 800, IR-800, to observe about 16 times fluorescence enhancement for IR-800. And then a model colon cancer biomarker is being used, CEA, and this is the assay of the protein microarray. So the same assay has been placed either on the plasmonic chips or the glass slides. The top panel represents the concentration from 100 picomolar down to 1 femtomolar concentration, a print of protein microarray, as well as the lower panel shows the on the glass substrate. So from here, you can clearly see the advantage of using plasmonic chips. The detection can be down to 1 femtomolar. And on the glass substrates, you barely see 10 picomolar. So this is the smaller one is being amplified, the signal. In this diagram shows CEA concentration versus fluorescence intensity, and it's basically corresponding to the protein microarray intensity here. You can see the dynamic range for this plasmonic chip can be on 6 orders of magnitude, while on the glass slide, and the sensitivity has been enhanced at least 5,000 fold. So this is very exciting news because we can use this technology to be adapted in current ELISA or protein microarray assays. And they also explore this multiplexed protein microarray. So the signal that 32 human antigens, human autoantigen and controls assay were triplicated. So each 3 dots represent the same concentration and same antigen, same assay. 3 different substrates has been used. This glass substrate and nitrocellulose substrate is quite popular in a lot of assay or protein microarray. And we also use our gold chips. We call it plasmonic gold chip. And from this image here, you can clearly see the contrast. It's being enhanced dramatically. So here give you richest information. The advantage of using this gold is the feature's intensity has been increased because of the fluorescence enhancement. And also the background, if you look at here, the background of this gold chip is actually much lower on the nitrocellulose because nitrocellulose will give you a lot of autofluorescence. So the background is about 10 times lower. From this, heat map, you will see we can observe the additional, especially these 4 different markers, which can't be seen on both glass and nitrocellulose, can be discovered or can be seen. This feature has been intensified on the gold chip. So So in summary, this plasmonic gold nanostructure will give you a very broad dynamic range and high sensitivity. The advantage of this broad dynamic range and high sensitivity is very, very useful for the protein microarray and for the multiplexed protein microarray. I'm going to briefly talk about using these kind of chips for in vitro bioimaging, for cell imaging, basically. So this is someone else's work in Manchester, a group in Manchester University. So they use this very random triangular or hexagonal gold on the microplates, and they're putting down this KB cell, which is oral cancer cell line. From this image, you can see generally you see much intense stands, the cell being stained by this particular dye. It's brighter compared to the background glass when they're sitting on the glass substrate. And here, I labeled H here. This particular cell, you can see on the metal surface, it's much brighter because half the cell is sitting on the metal and the other half is sitting on the glass substrate. So you can see the clearly contrast intensity here. The signal has been intensified, amplified on the surface of metal. And another cell, 3T3 cells, you can also see the LX404, 488 labeled, the histone H3 can be visualized much easier. So the feature is much more intensified compared on the glass light. So in summary, what I'm talking about here is a plasmonic material, or a very specific term is metal-induced fluorescence enhancements. I'm trying to promote this technology for protein microarray, for ELISA, for different applications. And the advantage of this technology is we don't need to change any instrumentation or anything. You just simply replace the glass light with these metallic nanostructures, and they will give you up to 1,000 times enhanced fluorescent signal. And at the moment, everyone is working on visible dyes or near IR dyes up to 790, for example, are using IR800 or LX404 790. The forefront of the technology is to push into IR region 2, which is 1100 to 1400, because in this region, there's no autofluorescence or autofluorescence is negligible. And the penetration depths of the fluorescence can be increased to 10 centimeters. So that's useful, for example, for breast cancer imaging. 10 centimeters is good enough to do a lot in vivo bioimaging. These two different dyes has been reported. It's quite useful. One is called silver sulfide quantum dots with a typical emission at 1200 nanometers. Another one is a lot more difficult to handle. It's a single wall carbon nanotubes. When it's single wall, there is very weak fluorescence. So the quantum yield for the single wall carbon nanotube is only 0.3 to 1%. And for for silver sulfide, quantum dot is about 10%. So again, the benefits of working in near IR region 2 is to increasing we can further increase the sensitivity, and we have a much deeper penetration. This is another example of using silver sulfide quantum dots for IR region 2 imaging. So basically, you label the silver sulfide quantum dots with this PEG system to make them biological friendly. And we inject these quantum dots into this nude mouse. And after only 30 minutes, you can differentiate the quantum dots intensity on the cancer site is gradually increased, and the background of the on different organs has been reduced. So this is after 24 hours in injection. You can clearly see the tumor has been labeled with these quantum dots. So this opened a door for us to see whether we can use this technology for fluorescence enhancement. So imagine if I tag another gold nanostars or whatever nanostructures on these quantum dots, the contrast will be even higher. So what I'm talking about here is metal-enhanced fluorescence technology. There has huge potential applications. So can we make a plasmonic-enhanced bioimaging using super bright conjugate? For example, single-wall carbon nanotubes is only 0.3% of quantum yield. So if it's tagged with one gold nanoparticle with one single wall carbon nanotubes, can we increase the quantum yield to 72%? Then we can take both advantage with strong fluorescence and no background. We can also use this plasmonic enhanced imaging, so this probe, as a carrier for the drug. So you function this conjugation with a drug for therapy purpose. As I said, I'm a physical scientist trying to work on the biotech area. So I'm looking for some clinical questions we can answer using this platform technology. So I call this platform technology. It's once we establish this technology, apply different clinical scenarios. For example, we are working on Parkinson's disease. For neuron growth, can we promote neuron growth, use these gold nanostars? Or can we use this technology for ovarian cancer detection? So this is our open questions. And at the moment, our lab is working on this much higher fluorescence enhancement factors and for all these substrates for sensing and for in vitro cell imaging. And we're also working on the solution-phased nanoparticles to make this, we call it super bright fluorescence probes for bioimaging. So for example, these nanostars, the reason we want these very sharp tips, because the sharp tips can concentrate the electromagnetic field. The field here will be 1,000 times higher than on the smooth surface. So this is very exciting. There's a lot of potential here for us to develop. I'd like to acknowledge a lot of my collaborators from all over the world. There's one group in Stanford and a number of groups based, some of them in Imperial College and some of them all over the UK. So Professor Eric Abergy is a cancer imaging director at our Imperial College London. And we're working on a lot of animal models and stuff like that. There's two groups in China working with Professor Zhao Dongyuan, and one group in Nanjing University, and also one group in Australia. I also like to thank my team members for hard work and the exciting research. Yeah, any questions? We do have a lot of different structures here. So this is most direct way to make triangle. So you have this polystyrene layer, and you utilize the evaporation. And if you tilt the evaporation, they can make hexagonal. So you basically need to do a lot of modeling to get this hexagonal structure. And as I said, the density is quite important. So the gap will give you a lot more.
Material closure available? the dye need to be controlled.
Could you use microphone?
And the question is, how do we attach dye to the metal surface? For example, in essay question, I probably go through the slide, it will be easier. So here, you can see this is capture antibody, and this is CEA antigens, what we want to detect. And this is the secondary and capture conjugations. So the IR800 here is tagged to the CEA. And both all these antibodies, antigens, control the distance between the between this dye to the surface. Because if this IR800 is too close to the surface or attaching, just sitting on the metal surface will quench the fluorescence. So they are like dual functional group here. They as an assay, they also work as a spacer. Yeah, yes, exactly.
So you need much steps self-assembly. So you first need to self-assemble the antibody,
right,
and then add the CEA.
This is a standard assay they used on the glass slides. So luckily, if you do the calculation, this is about 15 to 20 nanometers. Yeah, fix this distance, so we can see the enhancement.
So my question is easy, so thank you for the presentation. I think this is the science of the future. So I just want to ask you, so after the injection of the nanoparticles, there are some side effects, because it's in vivo experiment. The second question is, there is maybe some application after biopsy, or you just need to inject it by intravenous and do the diagnosis?
So the first question, this in vivo imaging, yes. We've done a lot toxicology study to make sure. So silver sulfide has been proved they are non-toxic to cell. Another big challenge here is when we inject them, how they being get rid of out of the system. So majority of the particle was sitting in the liver or spleen. So in terms of imaging, these are non-toxic stuff. But yes, there is concerns about how we get rid of these particles from the body system. So that's why it's kind of a lot more research need to be done for this toxicology, and especially long-term toxicology. We've done some very preliminary study on this Parkinson's disease for neurons. So we put neurons on this on the microplate. They actually will promote neuron growth rather than make them die or whatever.
My question is about the antibody that you graft into the surface of the nanomaterial.
Yeah.
It's for fluorescence 1, right?
Yeah.
And then if you are planning to apply it in the clinical trial,
yeah,
it means we have to graft another antibody around the drug. It means after loading the drug. Because cancer cells, they have receptor.
Uh-huh.
So it means it will kill 2 antibodies.
I don't really get your question. So, are you saying the sensing platform or imaging platform?
Both.
Okay.
Because for the fluorescence detection,
yeah,
there is this antibody,
yeah,
you use.
Uh-huh.
But if we apply in clinical trial, for example, in cancer cells,
yeah,
we have to put another antibody,
uh-huh,
like that the cancer cell will detect specifically this nanomaterial. So my question is that in there is any possibility that those, let's say, 2 antibodies will be in a competition in the cancer cells?
So are you saying one of the antibody is for imaging purpose, the
yes,
other one is for tagging?
Yes. Or only this one can play that role.
But the other one has been labeled with fluorescence, or what's probably we can discuss offline. I don't really get how you what's the assay structure you're talking about.
Okay. Thank you.
Welcome.
So what's your roughly size of the
nano
gold star?
For gold star, it's from 50 to 100. Because if the particle size is bigger than 100, it can't be can't be absorbed into the cell membrane. For in vivo imaging. But for the sensing platform, it doesn't matter what kind of shape and what kind of size.
Final question. You said when you deposit the cell to the gold surface. It can enhance the fluorescence. But have you ever thought when you deposit the cell to the non-uniform gold triangle hexagon surface, it gonna affect the cell's diffusion and adhesion for this surface? And also its activity.
I don't think so. In that paper, this is not my paper. In that paper, they said the surface. It's very friendly for like this paper. They said the cell viability and activity is exactly the same on the glass substrate.
And then let's thank again Dr. Francis.
Thank you.